additional practice questions on critical reasoning, the topic that we will be covering is assumption. Now, assumption, why I wanted to take up as a separate video, is one of the most vexing topics and the topic which confuses a lot of people, especially in these entrance exams. I have made a concept video which clearly culls out the most important characteristics and how do we approach an assumption question. Request you to go to that video in case you have not watched it before coming to the practice questions here. Let's move ahead. Now, what I want to do initially is give you a quick recap of what we have studied. And for example, how we want to start off is, let's say, by trying to understand what assumptions are in the first place. So assumptions are anything which is needed to complete the argument. And when I say complete the argument, assumptions are typically implicit by nature. So what does implicit mean? It is not stated. So any form of logical argument will be when you add a premise to an assumption, it gives you a conclusion. And this is the given fact. The set of given facts, when you add an assumption to that fact, which is not, you're not stating it, but you're assuming it, leads to a conclusion. So you need to understand assumptions as any argument, any point or any implicit argument that is absolutely needed to complete the whole argument. And when I this say argument, I'm essentially referring to conclusion here. That point is called as an assumption. So assumptions, you should remember, one, are before statements. So something that you have thought before. Number two, they are implicit. Number three, they are not consequences. And I don't want to touch upon in a great detail in this lecture, in this video, in terms of explaining why is it not a consequence and all. I just wanted to give you a quick recap for the ones who have already gone through the concept videos. In case you are not very clear of what we are doing here, I request you to go back to the concept video and get this clarity, because that's where we have done this portion of characteristics in great details. But I just wanted to call out before we start the questions. So one is, it's a before statement, something that you have thought before the main statement. These are implicit, they are not consequences. And number four is, they always have a causal agreement. Now what that means is, causality works in assumption. For example, if X leads to Y, basically what you're assuming is that nothing other than X leads to Y. And that's an important property we will continuously be using when we are doing questions around assumptions. So the point to understand, and I just want to quickly recap it, one is their before statement. So their statement told before the main statement. So what you have thought before the main statement essentially is the assumption. They're implicit, so they're never stated. If you have picked anything from the sentence which is stated, then it is not an assumption. They are not consequences. For example, something that's going to happen after you have spoken the main statement is a consequence, and assumptions are never consequences. And number four, assumptions always follow a causal arrangement. So the point is, and that's what I've tried to explain here, if something leads to something, then you're assuming that other than that point, nothing will lead to Y. For example, if X leads to Y, then you're assuming that nothing other than X will lead to Y. And that's, this property is extremely crucial in doing questions, and you will see how we'll use this XY property as we move on in the questions ahead. I hope this short recap was good enough for you to just regain all these concepts. Let's go to the questions. Let's look at the first question. It says that despite the fact that many professional writers consider travel writing a lesser form of journalism, it is in fact a legitimate journalistic enterprise since it employs classical journalism techniques such as detailed research into history, extensive interviews with local residents. So what the question is saying, that professional writers consider travel writing as a lesser form of journalism. So the travel writing is not equal to, let's say, journalism is what they're trying to establish. But it also says that it is in fact a legitimate journalistic enterprise since it employs classical journalism technique. But the author says that travel writing is actually a journalistic enterprise. Why? Because it involves classical journalistic techniques. such as detailed research and local extensive interviews. The argument above depends on which of the following assumptions. Now, what you have to understand here is, one, you are saying that travel writing is not considered as journalism. On the other hand, the author also says that it is in fact a legitimate journalistic enterprise. Why? Because it involves classical journalism techniques. So the idea that you need to really understand through an assumption, what is not spoken is the relation between classical journalistic techniques and the point of legitimacy. So your assumption has to bridge that gap. So the assumption has to talk about some form of relation between classical journalistic techniques and the legitimate journalistic enterprise. Only when you assume that the point of journalistic techniques is related to journalistic enterprise, only then saying that it is in fact a legitimate enterprise because it involves techniques makes sense. So this relation is what we'll have to find as an assumption. Let's look at the options. It says, if a literary work is crafted by extensive interviews, it should be viewed as legitimate. Now, interviews is just one part. So we have done that enough number of times to now know that a partial explanation should be eliminated clearly. If a literary work is crafted by extensive interviews of noteworthy subjects, then it should be viewed as legitimate. So interviews equals legitimate, that's not the relation, so that's gone. Since travel writing follows the method of traditional journalism, it will produce intriguing material for readers, and that's unknown for me and cannot be my assumption in this case, so that's gone. Any writing that does not employ classical techniques is a lesser form of journalism. Now, if I assume this, then I will not say that journalistic enterprise equals to journalistic techniques. So this is actually opposite. So this is opposite, and hence it's gone. Let's look at the fourth one. It says, if a literary pursuit involves classical journalism techniques, then it should be considered as a legitimate journalistic enterprise. And that's exactly what we were referring when we were doing the initial thinking around the question. That assumption is nothing but, in this case, the relation that can be drawn between the journalistic techniques versus the enterprise that it is legitimate. So this kind of talks about the same lines should be the answer mostly. The interview process used by travel writers can provide information about the history of a region. So that's again just one part of the explanation, and hence not the answer. The answer has to be D, where you say that if I have assumed that the journalistic techniques used gives you legitimacy, only then I can say that it is a legitimate enterprise. I hope this point was cleared in this question. Let's go to the next one. Now it says, copyright laws protect the rights of writers to profits earned from their writings, whereas patent laws protect inventors' rights to profits earned from their invention. So we're talking about two laws. Copyright laws, which are protecting the writers, and patent laws that are protecting the inventors. In Jawad, when computer software writers demanded that their rights to profit be protected, the courts determined that information written for a machine does not fit into either copyright or patent. Clearly, therefore, the profit rights of software writers remain unprotected in Jawad. So that's the question. So basically, if I were to understand this, it basically says that copyright and patent laws. So copyright is protecting the writing. It is protecting the inventions. But when we talk about software, it doesn't fall into either CR or PL. So the question, what it basically says is that since it doesn't fall under either copyright laws or patent laws, the profit rights remain unprotected. Which of the following is an assumption on which the argument depends? Now think of this. If the current code, the software for a machine that is written, is not governed by both copyrights and patent laws, and on the top of that you're also saying that they remain unprotected, essentially what you have thought of is that other than the copyright and patent laws, there's nothing else which can actually protect the software. So for example, for software, let's say for software, there could be another law another law. There could be another law. But we don't know from the question if the author is even considering this law. So what the author has definitely assumed is the fact that if software doesn't come under copyrights and patents, then it remains unprotected. In other words, there is no law other than these two which protects the writers or the software makers. So that has to be the assumption. Let's look at the options to figure that out. Computer software writers are not an influential enough group in Jawad for the government to consider modifying existing copyright. So this is pretty unknown. So this is very vague in terms of modifying computer copyright laws. So that's not needed. No laws exist other than copyrights and patents that would protect the profit rights. Yes, this has to be the assumption by default, which says I have assumed that there's nothing else other than these two which can protect the profit rights of software writers. Most of the computer software is imported, so that's irrelevant. Computer software is most similar to writings covered by copyright laws than it is to invention. So this is again out of scope. Don't know this. Anything which is not given in the question and you build around some understanding around that has to be unknown. So you eliminate that straight up. Copyright laws and patent laws in Jawad have not been modified. So is modification even in the point of protecting the rights of software? The answer is no. Therefore, it is E also gone. The answer definitely has to be B, where you say that no other laws other than copyrights and patents actually can provide the protection for profit rights of computer software writers. I hope this point was clear. Let's move on to the next question. It says that a study of 20 overweight men revealed that each man experienced significant weight loss after adding Slim Down. So after adding Slim Down, you experience significant weight loss, an artificial food supplement, to his daily diet. For 3 months, each man consumed one Slim Down portion every morning and exercising, and then followed his normal diet for the rest of the day. So see what's happening. What's happening is, on every morning, they did exercise, and after exercise, they consumed one Slim Down, and then they continued for the rest of the day as a normal diet. Clearly, anyone who consumes one portion of Slim Down every day for at least 3 months will lose weight and will look and feel his best. So basically what it says is that anyone who is taking this artificial supplement, one portion of artificial supplement every day for 3 months, will definitely lose weight. But what you also understand from the question is that these people on the Slim Down diet also are exercising. And this point becomes very crucial to understand the assumption in this case. Every morning after exercising, they're taking this Slim Down portion, which means even after knowing the fact, you are telling that anyone consumes one portion of Slim Down should lose weight, is essentially assuming that exercise. So basically what this assumes, what an assumption would be, is to understand that exercise is irrelevant in weight loss. That is what is assumed. Because if it is only Slim Down which is creating the weight loss, then even if you do exercise or not is irrelevant, and only Slim Down can help you to lose weight. Now let's try and look the same assumption in the options. The men in the study will gain back weight, so this you don't know whether they'll gain back or not. So that's gone. No other dietary supplement will have the same effect. You are only referring to Slim Down and not really bothered about other dietary supplements. So that's gone. The daily exercise was not responsible, and that's exactly what we're trying to figure out. Was not responsible for the effects noted. And only if you assume this, will you then say that taking one portion of Slim Down helps you to lose weight. So this should be the answer. Women don't experience similar weight reductions if they adhere. So again, this is very out of scope. Just because you're talking about men, we don't know anything from a women's standpoint. So that's gone. Overweight men will only achieve partial weight loss. Do you know this? So this is unknown. Whatever you don't know, whatever is not given is an unknown. Eliminate that straight away. And C has to be the right answer. That is assuming that it is just the supplement and not the exercise which is responsible for the weight loss. I hope this point was clear. Let's move on to the next question. Now it says, time and again, it has been shown that students who attend colleges with low faculty student ratios get the most well-rounded education. As a result, when my children are ready to attend college, I'll be sure that they attend a school with very small student population. So two things are happening. For a well-rounded education, what is must is a low faculty to student ratio. Now let's understand this bit. Now faculty to student ratio would mean that, let's say, for a population of 15 versus a population of, let's say, 20, this is the total population, this is students, and the faculty could be 1, here the faculties could be 2. Now if you create the ratio, so this will be 1 upon 15 and this will be 2 upon 20. In other words, 1 upon 15 and 1 upon 10, so 2 upon 20 is nothing but 1 upon 10, which effectively means for a class of 15 people, if you have one faculty, that will not be as great as if you have for every 10 students, you have one faculty, which essentially means that the number of small student population or a large student population actually doesn't determine the right ratio. For the ratios to be determined, it has to be a mix of how many faculties versus how many students. So this logic that small student population is not going to work, because as we saw in this example, that even with a smaller student population of 15, if you do not know the number of faculty, your ratio is not really low. So which of the following, if true, identifies the greatest flaw? And for me, that is the greatest flaw in the question, because you are not really doing the calculation from a ratio perspective. You have just taken into consideration a small student population. A low student faculty ratio is the effect of well-rounded, not its source. So this is not a flaw. Intelligence should be considered as a, so intelligence is very a term not discussed, so that's gone. A very small student population does not itself ensure a low student faculty ratio, and that's the point which we are trying to draw here, and that has to be the answer. Parental desires and preferences rarely determine, so these are very out of scope. Parental desires, preferences. Students must take advantage by intentionally choosing, again this is unknown, so that's gone. The answer has to be C, where you say that just considering a small student population does not ensure a student to faculty ratio. It is the number of faculty teaching the number of students that will determine the faculty slash student ratio, and not just a small population. I hope this point was clear. Let's move on to the next question. Our next question says that market researchers recently reported that people interviewed objected to a particular detergent's advertisement because of the portrayal of women. So what they're saying is, market researchers recently reported that 90% of the people interviewed objected to a particular detergent's advertisement because of the portrayal of women. So maybe the people who were interviewed did not like the way women were portrayed, and that's why they kind of objected to the detergent's advertisement. Yet this detergent is purchased by 21% of the consumers. So 21% bought it. So its advertisements must be considered to be unobjectionable to at least 21% of the consumers. So basically what the question says is that a company did some market research and reported that 90% of the people object to a particular detergent's advertisement because of the portrayal of women. In spite of that, there are some 21% of the consumers who are buying the detergent. So its advertisements must be considered to be unobjectionable at least to these people, because they are buying it. Now, the conclusion of the above argument depends on which of the following assumptions. What have I assumed for this to be told? If I'm telling that these 21% of the people are buying it and also they feel unobjectionable, essentially tells me that I am assuming that they have either seen the advertisement, or they have read the advertisement, or they are somewhere, maybe are aware of the advertisement. Only if they are aware of the advertisement and they still buy it, will I say that the whole point of advertisement was unobjectionable to them. See, there could be two cases. Let's look at those two cases. 21% people who, so they are watching advertisement, they are not watching advertisement, right? Now, in spite of watching or not watching, somebody can still buy it here. But if somebody has not watched the advertisement, then there is no point of objectionable or unobjectionable content. So the point of objectionable content or unobjectionable content only comes when somebody has watched the advertisement, which means you're not really referring to this category. The reference is to this category where you've seen, where you assume that people have actually watched or are aware or somewhere read about the advertisement, and because of which they're still buying it. Therefore, they are unobjectionable. Hence, the assumption has to be people who object to a product's advertisement may still buy that product. See, this is, you are talking about people who are buying it. So people who object will be the ones that are, that may or may not buy. So this is not what you're looking at. The people who buy this detergent are familiar with this advertisement. And this is the same point we're trying to understand here. And this should be the answer mostly. Because if you're assuming that in spite of being unobjectionable, they bought it, in spite of the fact that a lot of people objected to it and these people still bought it, so it must be considered unobjectionable to them, is only when you know that these people would have had some level of familiarity with the advertisement. So this has to be true. Most of the people who do not buy this detergent considered this, so this you don't know. Do not buy, consider this objectionable, this category is not known to me. Most people wash their clothes, so this is pretty vague. So that's eliminated. Most of the people in market research were women. Now, this is something again unknown, and secondly, it has no relevance to the point of this 21%. So that's also gone. The answer has to be B. When you say that it could only be unobjectionable when I assume that these people have some level of familiarity with the advertisement. I hope this point is clear. Let's move on to the next question. Now it says that the perceived value of goods and services rather than just their price, so it is the value rather than the price, is becoming an increasingly prominent factor in purchase decisions of modern consumers. So if you were to look at value versus price, it is definitely the value which is creating the major factor for buying decisions. And a new report has indicated that. Thus, it can be concluded that consumers will be increasingly willing to spend extra on goods and services that are high quality and durable. So, by now you would have realized that two things are being talked about. One is that value is of great importance. And number two, look at the conclusion. It says, thus it can be concluded that consumers will be increasingly willing to spend extra that are high quality and durable, which means high quality plus durability leads to spending. And you also know that it is not the price but the value, which means there has to be some link between high quality and value of the product. And this has to be the point of assumption that he has assumed. Let's try and figure out that point in the options. The price of product plays no role in making decisions. So no role in making decisions. This is very far-fetched. That's gone. There's a positive relation between quality of a product and its durability. Positive relation, I don't know what that means. We'll park it for now. The modern consumer is not likely to allow the quality to determine his purchase decision. That is opposite to the statement, so that's gone. The ideal way for manufacturers to charge more for their products is to increase the perceived value in the minds of modern consumers. So again, this although has been spoken about, but this is just one part of the whole explanation. Why? Because in the conclusion, it says that it is the high quality and durability which leads to more spending. And the first part talks about perceived value. So there has to be some link between perceived value and high quality. So this is just one part of it. So that's gone. The durability of a product is in some way related to its perceived value. And that's exactly what we were trying to figure out in this whole point. That if the only when the author assumes that quality plus durability equals to value, only then can he make this statement. And this has to be the assumption, and therefore the right answer. The positive relation between quality and product and its durability also is pretty one-sided. Doesn't really talk from an overall context, so I'm going to eliminate that. And this is very clear in my mind that this has to be the assumption, because assumption is nothing but the gap between the conclusion and what's stated. Just think of it like that. Assumption is nothing but the gap between what's stated as the conclusion, in this case, high quality and durability, and what's given, which is value. So anything that addresses the gap is the assumption. I hope this point was clear. Let's move on to the next question. Now it says that while personal cell phones have facilitated instantaneous connections with people, texting is a cause of underdeveloped communication. So it basically says that although cell phones facilitate instantaneous connections, texting is a cause of underdeveloped communication in children. When a child is texting his friends and not actually getting on the phone to talk or not interacting in person, the child is losing out on interpersonal skills. Therefore, children who spend their spare time texting their friends have less experience in oral communication than other children have. So what basically it says is that if you are having a cell phone and if you're doing testing, then the communication skills in children is not going to be developed because you're spending most of your time in texting and not really focused on interpersonal communication skills. So therefore, children who spend their spare time texting their friends are likely to experience lesser capability in oral communication. So that's what is thought about. So what you need to understand in this is the point that one, the point of oral communication related to texting, and second point, what happens if you're not testing? What happens when you are not texting? So the answer has to have a relation between the two, and that should be the assumption, because you're assuming that who spent their spare time texting have less experience in oral communication than other children, and that's the conclusion. And what you have also given is texting is a cause of underdeveloped communication, which means the gap has to be something that talks from these aspects. Let's look at the options. Passive activities such as watching and listening to music do not hinder. Listening to music is not given in my scope, so that's out of scope. Gone. Most children have other opportunities. Other opportunities out of scope again. Gone. Children who do not spend all of their school hours texting spend at least some of their time in oral conversation with other people. Now, this is what is covering here. Children who do not spend all of their school hours texting. So the ones who are not texting, the author is assuming that they're spending at least some time in conversing. And that's why he's against the fact that texting decreases your social capability. Because he's assuming that children who are not spending time in school texting are talking. So this has to be the assumption that the author has. Formal instruction contributes little. So again, you don't know what is that formal instruction. Is it equal to testing? Don't know that. The written communication skills developed through texting do not contribute. Now, this whole point of written communication skills is not talked about. It's an unknown again. Therefore, eliminated. The answer has to be C. I hope this point was clear. What we try to do is figure out what's given. Again, we are just following the same logic throughout these questions. Understand what's given. Understand the conclusion. Figure out the gap. The gap has to be the assumption. So what the author has assumed in this case is the ones who are not spending time in school for texting are spending time in talking to people. So if they're talking to people, then they're not texting and their skills are getting improved. And that's exactly the whole point of this passage. I hope this was clear to you. Let's move on to the next question. It basically says, a business owner says, this new technology will allow us to track everything that happens at our store. So there's some new technology that's gonna help them to track everything that happens at the store. From delivery arrival times to the volume of sales made within each hour. Because we can now track which associates sell the highest volume within each period, we will now know which of our salespeople are most effective at their jobs. Now, what basically the question says is there is some technology which is helping you to track everything that's happening in the store. From delivery arrival times to the volume made each hour. And because of which, now what you can do is, so if there is a salesperson, you can today find the effectiveness of salesperson by just tracking the sales volume. So if you track the sales volume, that leads to effectiveness. And that's what the author is trying to establish. So what is the gap is, and this is again, I will go back to the recap when we were talking about X leads to Y. If X leads to Y, what did I tell you? I told you that there are no other factors other than X. No other factor other than X leads to Y. And that's a similar condition here, that the effectiveness of salesman is directly proportional to the tracking. So your assumption has to be that there are no factors other than this, which defines the effectiveness. Let's look for that option. Different time periods during a day are no more likely to have higher sales figures. Time periods is not in your consideration, so that's gone. The tracking technology will be convenient and inexpensive. This is very out of scope. Is price and convenience even a point discussed? The answer is no, so therefore you eliminate. All salespeople have different periods of the day in which their sales volume are the highest. That could still mean that if somebody is selling highest at each point, that the technology will be able to track that and therefore effectiveness can be achieved. So this is not the assumption which I'm making. The assumption has to be this. There are no factors other than sales volume that impact how effective a salesperson is at the job. And only when I assume this will I say that after this technology, we'll be able to know which of our salesperson are the most effective, because you're assuming that there are no other factors other than the volume, the sales volume, which impact the effectiveness of the salesperson. And therefore, this has to be the right assumption. There are no seasonal variations, so that point is pretty unknown to me. And that's gone. So the answer has to be D. I hope this question was clear to you. Assumptions, and you should remember that assumptions are something which really need you to understand the logic very well, understand the conclusion and figure out the gap. I think all these questions would really help you to do so. Let's go to the next question.